that music means it's time for me to welcome you guys to a special Monday night edition of Rookies Roundup. I'm your host, Jake Leiker, a.k.a. Rookie, and it is currently 8 o'clock sharp here in L.A., finally on time. And we have some of our best broadcasts yet for you guys tonight. First off, hope you guys are all having a great three-day weekend and a happy Labor Day. Now, to me, Labor Day means two things. First, it means it's almost my birthday. And second, and more importantly, we are less than a week away from the NFL season beginning. 3 days away, the wait is almost over. And because we can't get enough football here at Rookies Roundup, tonight's going to be a special NFL prediction episode. Hear how tonight's episode is going to work. I'm going to have a bunch of guests on tonight's show, and each of them will join me to discuss a big topic in sports world. After that topic is wrapped up, we go into the Super Bowl predictions. They might feel like mini rants or debates, almost first take style, and I figured I'd do that because I didn't do a single rant last week. Also, no quick hits tonight. I'm sure you guys know what's going on in the sports world already, and when I made the show, I was aiming more for a fresh spin on controversial topics, so expect less quick hits and more debates in the future. I'm going to tell you tonight's topics and more information after I bring in our first guest of the night, Ian Martin. I'm just going to call him up. Hey, Ian, how you doing? Thanks for being on the show tonight.
I'm doing great, Jake. How are you doing?
Ooh, I'm good. It's a nice way to end up a three-day weekend. So I know you mentioned that earlier that you were pressed for time. Really appreciate you coming here, especially on the night before school. So let's get right to it. You ready?
Yep.
All right, well, for every guest I have tonight, I'm going to ask one trivia question, see if they can get it right. They're pretty tough. I don't expect anyone to get it right, just for the fun of it. So, quick trivia question. Which active player in the NFL has the most career fumbles?
Most career fumbles in the NFL. Any position?
Any position.
I'm going to have to call to the top one. I think it's a running back. Pretty sure about that. I'll go with... Ray Rice.
I can tell you that it's not a running back. It's a quarterback. I'll give you one last guess, and then we'll go into our first topic.
Repeat.
I can tell you it's a quarterback. I'll give you one more guess. Yeah.
I'll go with Joe Flacco.
The correct answer is Michael Vick. Number two is Tom Brady. Number three is Eli Manning. Michael Vick was the correct answer. All right. So, the most polarizing figure right now in all of sports, arguably, college football for certain, is Johnny Manziel. Now, we all saw what he did on Saturday. He got ejected after the taunting penalty. He was suspended for the first half for the whole autograph thing. A lot of excessive celebration. What's your take on Manziel?
Well, for me, he's another superstar young freshman who thinks he's better than everybody. But he's a great football player. He's a great quarterback. But the thing that will end up killing him in the end of all this is his just selfishness and ability to not understand like where the limit is. He just keeps going past the limit.
Do you think his attitude is going to affect his play in the future when they're playing tougher SEC teams like Bama next week? I mean, he's only played one half. Less than against Rice. Do you think he's going to be doing that against Bama?
I think he might. If they have a lead, he definitely will be. But if he... I'm a big Texas man, and I'm fan. I'd like to see them win a lot more. I like what they've done down there. But I feel like if they end up winning against Alabama, then Johnny Manziel will just go all out, and I think he'll get suspended again, get some more taunting penalties, some more of that stuff. But if he's losing, I think that could possibly put an end to all this, kind of give him a sense that he's not better than everybody. He beat Alabama last year at Alabama. I feel like coming home, know, losing might give them a little reality check.
So here's my question for you. I know my answer for this one. It's a tough one. Who are you rooting for? Alabama or Texas A&M?
Well, like I said, I'm a Texas A&M fan, but I want to see Johnny Manziel grow up a little bit, so I'm rooting for Alabama. They're honestly the best team in college football. There's no way around that.
I can't stand Alabama. I can't stand rooting for the number one team. But Johnny Manziel has left me no choice. It's for his own good. It's time for him to get off his high horse. So I can't believe I'm saying this, but I hope Alabama wins to shut this kid up, you know? He's acting like a little punk out there.
That's what I really hope happens. I think a lot of people think that should happen just because he's such a good football player and it'd be a shame to see that kind of talent go away.
Yeah, it really would. Hopefully he gets it together. Now, of course, I mentioned tonight's episode is really about Super Bowl predictions. So, Ian, you're a big Seahawks fan. You're from the state of Washington. Are they your Super Bowl pick, or is it somebody else?
I'm going to stay with the Seattle Seahawks. Just because I watched a lot of preseason games, and I've known this coming 2 years now, but I think they have the most depth in all of the NFL right now, going up and down their lineup, up and down with depth chart. There's just no one that's like a weak spot. There's no single position that you go to when you're looking at them to say, okay, let's try to take advantage of this position. But a lot of the Seahawks players that got cut this past weekend actually got picked up. 49ers picked up a couple of the guys who got cut, actually. So, in my mind, that shows kind of a sign of worryness from the 49ers.
Yeah, they're such a well-rounded team. It's ridiculous. I mean, quarterback, running back, wide receiver, secondary, defensive line, linebacker, they've got everything covered. So if they're going to win the Super Bowl, my question is, who are they going to beat in the AFC? Who's going to go to the Super Bowl in the AFC?
The AFC is a really tough conference to predict for me because there's really two teams and they're just so evenly matched. The Cincinnati Bengals and the Denver Broncos. Cincinnati Bengals have the youth, they have the energy, but I believe the Seahawks will be facing the Denver Broncos just because Peyton Manning is such an awesome quarterback. He's a veteran, been here before. Demaryius Thomas has been there. All these guys have been there, but what could be a key factor is the first six games of the season when Von Miller is not on our roster. Without Elvis Dumervil, I believe they don't really have a good pass-rushing threat. So, I don't know, that could come out to be a factor, or it could not be a factor. I'm not sure, it's too early to really predict for me.
Yeah, Denver's really lucky that they're in the AFC West. It's such a tough conference to predict. Peyton, you know, you never know what he's going to do in the playoffs. It's a huge toss-up. So you're saying Seattle over Denver in the Super Bowl?
Yeah, I think in the end it's going to be Seattle over Denver, just because Denver, Peyton Manning will get tired out. I'm not sure if he'll be able to go in an entire 20 games, but like I said, it comes down to Von Miller, and the Denver Broncos can rally around, I'm not sure who will step up to fill that pass rushing option there in the first 6 games, but somebody's got to do it for them to become even possibly a playoff team.
Yeah. Well, again, I know you said that you were pressed for time. I really appreciate you coming on. I just want to ask you one last question, and I'll let you go. I liked the predictions, by the way. I think good chance those will prove correct. You'd certainly know your stuff, especially when it comes to the Seahawks. So my question is, of the teams that made the playoffs last year, name one that is most likely to disappoint.
I'm going to say Washington Redskins. I know a lot of people are hyped up on RG3, but in my mind, he's just a gigantic injury waiting to happen again. Coming off this knee ACL thing, and if he's not really 100% for them, it's hard to get Alfred Moore going because they don't have a stellar offensive line. They don't have a stellar passing game. It kind of was built around RG3 and Alfred Moore's the option, running the ball, screen passes, all that stuff. And if you don't really have another, like, target or another, like, go-on or lay-on-to receiver or tight end, you can't really just run the ball over and over. say the Washington Redskins are my pick to disappoint for coming up here.
Yeah, we'll see if RG3 goes through that sophomore slump. Ian Martin, everybody, thank you for being on. Appreciate it.
No problem, Jake, but always love to.
Thanks, man. See you. All right. That was Ian Martin, of course. So, yeah, I contacted him earlier, like just a couple hours ago, and he said, I was like, could you do the show tonight? He's like, yeah, but I'd have to come on pretty early. I got school tomorrow. You gotta do it quickly. And I'm like, no problem. So, big thanks to him. Really, everybody in national sports. We're all going on each other's shows. We really appreciate it when we can help each other out. So, big thanks to Ian and everybody else who's going to be on the show tonight, who's cutting it close or has school tomorrow. And thanks for everyone who's listening to the show, who's got school tomorrow. Or whatever you have school, if you're lucky enough that you don't have school yet. We're still thankful for every viewer we have. Now, before we got to that talk with Ian, I mentioned that I was going to tell you the topics for tonight. So we went through Johnny Manziel's antics. We got the other three. Tim Tebow's future in the NFL. I know you guys never get tired of hearing about him. So that's your NFL question. We got an NBA question. What team in the Eastern Conference has the best chance of beating the Heat? And we got a baseball question. NL Rookie of the Year. Yasiel Puig or Jose Hernandez? Also, as I mentioned to Ian, we're going to be doing some trivia over the night, so stay tuned to play along. We've got a bunch of good ones. Well, you also get my predictions, you get what the experts are saying, and of course it wouldn't be an episode of Rookies Roundup if we didn't have an MVP and a Facepalm Award, as well as our sympathy vote. But everybody's got predictions, everybody has opinions. If you think you don't, you're lying. You just need to look harder. Make your voice heard by calling into the show at 310-922-9536. That's 310-922-9536. Or if you're not listening live, leave a comment below. Even if you are listening live, leave a comment. Love to hear what you guys have to say. Really appreciate it, and I will answer as many as I can. So as I mentioned before, National Sports, a Rookies Roundup is part of the National Sports family on Spreaker.com, and I really do mean it when I say it's a family. We all know our stuff, we all listen to each other's shows, and you should too. We fill in for each other. The Blake and Noah show was earlier this week, and I remember Blake wasn't able to come in, and Noah asked me if I could fill in, and I came in on the spot, and we did an entire episode together. We're all there for each other. We all really know our stuff, we all trust each other, and they're a really fun group of guys. They're definitely worth your time when it comes to listening to them, so check out our Facebook page, at National Sports. Follow us on Twitter, at All Caps National Sports 1, and check out our Instagram page, National_Sports. If you're listening to this broadcast, share the link online. Tell everybody you can, because the more people that listen to the show, the better it is. Last thing, before we kick things off, last week we did something new on Rookies Roundup. In case you guys didn't want to listen to the whole broadcast for some reason, I put down how long into the broadcast each segment starts in the description box so you could fast forward to the point of the segment you want to hear. But lucky for you, we're not going to be doing that tonight, and you get to listen to the entire episode. For this episode, we're not going to be able to do that. It's a big show tonight. Some people, as mentioned before, have school tomorrow, couldn't make it. I was trying to get as many guests as I could. So we're trying to just throw everything together. But, you know, sometimes it's better when things aren't scripted. The show must go on is what they say. You know, you got people who had to be on no later than 8:15, no sooner than 9:30. So it's going to be a longer show than usual, and it's going to be a better show than usual, I'm sure of it. So we're going to have our next guest in a little bit. But first, I just wanted to weigh in a little more on the Johnny Manziel topic, because I didn't get to elaborate on that, and I have some pretty strong feelings about it. If you ask me when it comes to Johnny Manziel, the things he's doing, the show me the money thing, the signing autographs, that was the worst one, pointing to the scoreboard, it's what Ian said. You hate to see such great talent go to waste. This kid's so cocky and overconfident. I'm not saying that he's a bad player. because no one's going to deny that Johnny Manziel has an incredible talent when it comes to football. You win the Heisman as a freshman. It's incredible. He's incredible. He's amazing to watch. And I think, despite what he says and does, it's great for college football. Because everybody wants to watch him. Nobody can get enough of him. Whether you hate him or love him, he captivates you. You want to watch him. Now, whether or not you want to watch him succeed or fail, that's your choice. I feel about Johnny Manziel the same way I feel about the Denver Nuggets. They got arrogant. They thought they were so good, and I can't wait to see them fail and realize that they don't. The Nuggets fired George Karl because they thought that George Karl wasn't getting it done, only getting them to the first round of the playoffs year in, year out, even though they were never supposed to be a playoff team. It's the same thing with Manziel. Manziel thinks he's so great, and he's going to have to learn how to lose to know how to win. That's a quote from an Aerosmith song. Correct me if I'm wrong in the comment section below. I'm going to be really hoping that somebody says something. Everyone's got an opinion. Use it. Even if you want to correct me on my Aerosmith knowledge, which isn't much of. But, you know, I know some stuff, I think, when it comes to music. For sports, I know my stuff. I can promise you that. With Manziel, though, he's cocky. He's arrogant, and he's a little punk that needs to learn his lesson. Otherwise, he never will. And it's going to take a loss against Alabama. Otherwise, he's going to think he's invincible. He's going to bully everybody around. And when you go up to those Rice students in the third quarter, up 3 touchdowns and start signing autographs, that's pathetic. Really, everybody knows how great you are. The Rice players know how great you are. That's why you're up 3 touchdowns. Don't rub it in like that. It's just not right. No, this kid's got to learn his lesson. And you know you're doing something wrong if you can get me to root for Alabama. Alright, so that's what you heard me say about Johnny Manziel. Just, I get a visceral reaction to this guy. He needs to cut it out. I'm getting a little redundant, so before I continue to repeat myself, we're going to go to a commercial break. The trivia question for the next guest is, how many FCS teams defeated an FBS team this week? Stay tuned to find out. It's a commercial. We'll be back after this quick break.
Your presentation of national sports is brought to you by Spreaker.com. Broadcast and listen to new radio and music with one low monthly rate. Your show will be right back after this word from the local stations.
Welcome back to Rookies Roundup. Remember how before I was telling you that we're all family in national sports? Well, that's not the only family I have. I've got my own family, the people I live with, for better or for worse. So, when I needed someone to fill in because I couldn't get as many guests as I needed, there are upsides, believe it or not, of having a younger brother, especially one that, I can't believe I'm saying this, likes the Miami Heat. He's a big Tampa Bay Buccaneers fan. He wants to try this out. So, it is my pleasure to welcome into the show my younger brother, Elijah Liker. How you doing, Elijah?
Good, how are you?
I'm good. I'm sure you're feeling good after 2 straight wins with the Heat. The worst part is that you're not a bandwagon. I can't hold that against you. You actually were a real Miami Heat fan for how long? For like, since you were 2? Since you were 3? Like, something ridiculous. Alright, so you heard my trivia question. How many FCS teams this week defeated an FBS team?
Well, I want to know how many games there were between FCS and FBS teams.
I can't give that to you, but I can tell you this. Many FBS teams like to play FCS teams early on in the season and pay them a boatload of money because they think it's a free win, except for a certain number of teams this week who somehow lost. It was more, I think it was the most in history. I'll get on that later on. What's your guess? Just give me a number.
12.
Okay, well, we're getting a little carried away. I'll give you one more guess. Lower.
8.
Correct. 8 FCS teams defeated FBS teams. Notably, Eastern Washington defeated number 25 Oregon State. I believe Eastern Washington was FCS champions last year. You know, Boise State's not the only team with the colored field. Eastern Washington, check out their field. Google that. Bright scarlet red field, even better than Boise State's, if you ask me. Now, you are a Miami Heat fan, so I want to know from a Heat fan perspective. I'm sure you think that they're going to make it to the finals and win it all again. Which team in the Eastern Conference scares you the most? I'm going to give you, of course, some options, because there are a lot more options this year. The Knicks, the Nets, the Pacers, even the Pistons getting some big acquisitions, if they can pull off a miracle. There's even more. Anybody can pull this off. What's the one team that you are scared of the most that could beat you in a 7-game series come playoff time and could take your spot in the NBA Finals?
Boy, I hate to say this. I've been thinking about this. I'm going to have to go with the Cleveland Cavaliers.
Wow. First of all, how happy would every single person at ESPN and TNT be if the Heat and the Cavs were a matchup? How many ratings do you think that would get? Dear Lord, could you imagine? First of all, I would love it if that happened, especially if Cleveland won. You know how I feel about LeBron James. What's so scary about Cleveland all of a sudden?
I feel like Dion Waiters is gonna be amazing. Anthony Bennett will also be really good, and then I think Bynum, he'll start off slow, but then I think that he'll do good.
Yeah, it's not enough to say, he'll do good, he'll do good. Why? Why is Dion Waiters going to be good? Why is Anthony Bennett going to be, why is Andrew, first of all, is Andrew Bynum really going to be that good?
Yes, I think he'll return to his form that last year he had with the Lakers.
Hopefully he doesn't return to that bowling form that got him injured, or that brain form that decided it was a good idea to get that ridiculous haircut. It was like a bowl cut 2.0. So, you didn't mention one player on Cleveland that I don't know how you didn't.
There you go.
No, I hope that was a joke.
It wasn't.
It wasn't a joke. So we're just going to completely disregard that Kyrie Irving is on this team.
Oh, I thought you meant, like, besides him.
Well, yeah, I mean, it does kind of go without saying. Why does Kyrie Irving scare you? What about him is so threatening?
I mean, his finesse moves, it's not just that, but his chemistry, he's not, like, big ego player. He'll be, I think this is the year that he'll be an MVP candidate.
He could be, and I mean, the Cavs are shaping up to be back into the playoffs here. The Cavs, it's an interesting pick. I like Irving, and I think you're right, that there aren't chemistry issues with Cleveland, and that if there's any team that's going to be inspired to beat Miami, it will be Cleveland. They almost snapped the Heat's win streak last year. But let me ask you, when there are so many other good teams in the Eastern Conference, why are you more scared of the Cavs than the Nets or the Pacers?
You know, the Nets, I think that the veterans will start to slowly, like, you know, trail off, not do well. They'll start their decline, and I think it's too many stars. It'll kind of be like the Lakers.
Many people said the same thing about Miami, and look where they are now.
Well, you know, that was 3 stars.
That was 3. And how many? First, is Paul Pierce and Kevin Garnett, are they still really stars? Is Deron Williams a star? He seems really overrated. Ever since he left Utah, I mean, remember the old Utah Jazz days, though, when they didn't have this weird new logo, and it was all Carlos Boozer, Jerome Williams, Andre Kirilenko, when Derek Fisher made that crazy comeback after visiting his daughter in the hospital and the cancer treatment worked, and then he flew across the country into the game. It still gives me chills. I mean, you couldn't write that in a movie. Yeah, the Jazz days were pretty good, and then Williams comes to the Nets, and he's completely trailed off. And what about the Pacers? The Pacers almost and should have beat you guys last year if it wasn't for Frank Vogel. Don't wave your hand at me. You know, if Frank Vogel had half the brain of any other coach in the NBA, they would have won Game 1, and there would never have even been a Game 7. And you know that's true.
And that 3 was very lucky in the Game 1. Well, I hate Frank Vogel as much as anyone does. His personality, it totally pisses me off. But the Pacers, I really like them. But I don't know why. I just don't feel it.
You just don't feel it.
I don't really know.
Kind of like Manu Ginobili not feeling it in Game 7 of the Finals. You want to talk about lucky? You want to talk about being lucky? How about the way Miami found a way to win in the Finals last year? That's lucky. I'm going to finish talking about the Heat because I'm going to barf if I continue to say Miami and LeBron James' name over and over again. Let's talk about what we're really here for. And this is the part where I can poke some fun at you because you're a Heat fan and you're awesome. But you're also a Buccaneers fan, which makes you terrible and the worst franchise in the history of the NFL. And that is statistically true. They have the worst total record in the NFL and they ruined Bo Jackson's college baseball career. And the creamsicle jerseys, they speak for themselves. So I get to poke fun at you for that, because I'm a Packer fan. Which means I'm never going to let you live down anything Tampa Bay does, except for that time you beat us when we were 0-8 a few years ago. But that's besides the point. Super Bowl picks. If you say Tampa Bay, I am kicking you off this show right now. But I think you're smarter than that. Who is going to the Super Bowl in the NFC?
The NFC, I'm going to have to roll to the Bucks. No, okay.
You better be.
I'm going to have to go with the San Francisco 49ers.
Whoa. The 49ers again. With their head coach, Mr. Temper Tantrum himself, Mr. Harbaugh, the other Harbaugh, you know, the one that doesn't have a ring because they weren't good enough. What's so great about San Francisco? Why are they better than Seattle? Green Bay? Why are they better than Atlanta?
Atlanta, I know they're very underrated. I just don't like them as a favorite. I think that Matty Ice is, you know, he won't do well in the playoffs. And the whole Falcons team will not do well in the playoffs. Now, for the Packers, their decline will start to start. Not with Aaron Rodgers.
We're not talking about that yet. We are talking about who's going to make it to the Super Bowl in the NFC, and you said San Francisco, and now I'm ready to tear your argument apart. First of all, the only reason they made it last year was because nobody had any clue what Colin Kaepernick was going to do. How do you think the Packers let up that 60-yard read option run in the playoffs? Because they didn't know it was going to happen. Colin Kaepernick's lost the element of surprise, number one. Number two, you said yourself when we were talking about NBA, there's too many stars. The Niners have now picked up Anquan Boldin. Mario Manningham is starting to get healthy. How many personalities can you have on top of your coach, who counts as 3 LeBron Jameses in one? How is this team not going to self-destruct? What do they still have that they had last year?
They're going to have, well, obviously their players, but that experience in the playoffs, they've already had that before, but I still think, I really like San Francisco. I think that they will beat Seattle just because, you know.
Just because, you know.
Yeah.
That's a completely valid excuse.
Like, I still don't get the big talk about, oh, Seattle's going to be so good. You know, really,
Let me tell you the
all they got is Percy Harvin. Just saying.
Okay. it's about to go down. I was about to have you leave a little short because we're pressed for time, but this begs an argument. Tell me when you hear a weak spot for Seattle. I'll just go over all the basic positions. Quarterback, Russell Wilson, a second-year guy who normally I wouldn't put faith in, but again, this is a guy who beat Tom Brady last year, a guy who technically kind of, sort of-ish beat Aaron Rodgers, which I hate to say, but technically in the scorebooks it's true, a guy who led his team to score over 100 points in a two-week span against the Bills and the Cardinals. They beat the Cardinals 58-0. When they beat bad teams, they crushed them. And when they played good teams, they were still able to beat them. They beat San Francisco 42-13. So there's that. They're running back Marshawn Lynch. Do you really want to mess with Beast Mode and the Skittles? No, you don't. I can already answer that for you. Wide receiver, Percy Harvin. Golden Tate, who I absolutely hate almost as much as Johnny Manziel. And Sidney Rice. That's offensive side. Let's go to the defensive side. The best secondary in the league. Cam Chancellor. Richard Sherman, who I know you absolutely love. And on the defensive line, you have Cliff Averill. And you've even got your linebackers covered. Where are the Seahawks lacking?
I don't think they're lacking anywhere, but
if they're not lacking anywhere, how are they not going to make the Super Bowl?
Listen here. Russell Wilson will have a sophomore slump. Let's see. Richard Sherman, I think that his personality will get the best of him. And Marshawn Lynch, I love. I can't say anything bad about him. Percy Harvin, he's going to be injured. Sidney Rice is trash.
Are you saying that Percy Harvin might be a headache for the Seahawks? Yeah, you know, I really got to get a cricket effect on this because that was one of my best bad puns ever. But if they're not lacking, I don't see how they make it. But to each their own. We are running out of time. I could bash you in more ways than one about what you're saying with Seattle. And I hate to do that because I'm a Packer fan. AFC. That's a tough one. Who wins the AFC championship?
The Jaguars. No.
The Buccaneers and the Jaguars. You heard it here. It is an all-Florida Super Bowl in a snowstorm in New York between the Buccaneers and the Jaguars. More like when hell freezes over.
For real, I have the Denver Broncos.
Okay, so for the second time in a row, we have someone that takes the Denver Broncos, and we're just going to ignore and forget about the fact that Peyton Manning is 9-11 in the playoffs.
I don't really care.
You don't really care?
No.
You know who should care? The Denver Broncos and Peyton Manning.
No, I don't care because we're going to forget about all of that. He's going to forget about all of that. And he will go on to the Super Bowl.
Okay. Here are your three wide receivers that everyone is absolutely gaga over and is probably going to be the biggest disappointment of the year come postseason. Wes Welker is going to disappoint. Wes Welker is past his prime. The Patriots were geniuses to get Danny Amendola over Wes Welker. Demaryius Thomas, fine. And he's good enough to be a number one receiver. I'll give him that. And then Eric Decker, who is too busy with his reality show. And what's his wife's name? I don't know. Do you know his wife's name? What's her face? We are calling Eric Decker's wife Mrs. What's Her Face from now on. Eric Decker's going to disappoint. On defense, they don't have defense. Vaughn Miller's out for the first six games of the season. Did we not see what Raheem Moore did last year? Did we not see them give up 38 points to the Joe Flacco-led Baltimore Ravens in zero-degree weather? What's so great about them this year? Why are they going to do it this year?
The star-studded wide receivers. I think that is disgraceful what you say about Wes Welker.
Going all Stephen A. on me now, okay.
Demaryius Thomas, he's a boss. He'll have a breakout year, and so will Eric Decker. I think all three of them will be in the Pro Bowl. you know, I'm not saying the Pro Bowl matters that much. But I'm just saying
it's a fantasy. It's a fantasy draft. The Pro Bowl is a real life Madden because they get a fantasy draft, and nobody really gives a crap when it comes to real life. We all know it's true. Okay, we are seriously pressed for time, and when I say it this time, I mean it. Quickly, who wins the Super Bowl? The San Francisco 49ers or the Denver Broncos?
Two-seed 49ers or the two-seed Broncos?
Hold on. Who's going to be better than the Denver Broncos?
What?
Who's going to be one seed in the AFC?
Cincinnati Bengals.
Talk about that later and why that is absolute bullcrap. And who's going to be number one in the NFC?
I did not mean that. The Seahawks will be number one in the NFC. Niners will be number five.
Okay, fine.
Sorry.
Wait, the Seahawks are going to be better than the Niners in the division.
In the regular season.
Fine. Okay. Sorry. Who's going to win? Just say it. Spit it out.
San Francisco 49ers.
That is bullcrap, and if we had more time, I could go over my points. Kaepernick should just stick to magazine shoots and whatnot, but this time he could put his clothes on.
Don't hate on the Nevada QB.
The Nevada QB. Whatever. Well, thank you for giving us some diversity on this show. My brother, Elijah Liker, who was literally my brother, member of the family, thanks for having my back, filling in when I needed you. I hate the heat. The Buccaneers aren't going to do anything this year, but I still value somewhat your opinion. Thanks for being on the show. See you later.
Thank you. Heat 3-peat all the way.
Oh, God. I live with him. You know how often I hear heat 3-peat all the way? More times than I can bear. I'd rather claw my ears off. All right. So, we still have time to fill. In a few moments, we're going to have our next topic. But, since we have someone who can't even be on the show till 9:30, which I love because I get to be on the air more, and we get to talk about sports. I mean, I could split the show up into two and take some 15-minute break, but I'd rather talk about sports, and that's why you're listening. You want to hear me talk about sports, or you want to hear anybody. Hopefully, I'm good enough for you. So we've already heard two picks so far. Now, let's talk about this week's picks. We're going to do this every week for the next 17 weeks in the Rookies Roundup Crystal Ball. The NFL matchups for this week, they start on Thursday. It's so close. It's the best feeling ever. 3 days from now, the Broncos and the Ravens open up in Denver against each other. By the way, that's a slap to the face and everybody in Denver that they have to hang Joe Flacco posters all over the place. That's a disrespect to one of the best franchises in the NFL. But they will get their revenge. The Broncos are winning that game easy. I don't expect the Ravens to impress this year. They've just lost too much, including motivation and fire. They lost Ray Lewis. I just don't think it's going to happen again. And Denver's going to want their revenge. That's a win for Denver. Morning games. Let's take New England over Buffalo in Buffalo. Let's go Cincinnati over Chicago in Chicago. That's going to be a good one. Miami and Cleveland. That's an interesting matchup between two sophomore quarterbacks. But I'm going to take the Miami Dolphins over Cleveland in Cleveland. Minnesota and Detroit. We heard what Adrian Peterson said. He said that he is going to break the single-season rushing record this year. Personally, I don't think that's going to happen, just because what he did is so amazing that it would be stunning if he repeats that. I'm rooting for him, though. I want him to break it, as long as it doesn't happen against the Packers. But the more he plays the Packers, the better, to be quite honest, because we don't really play defense, and neither do the Detroit Lions. And that's why I'm going to take the Minnesota Vikings in opening week in Detroit. Oakland travels to Indianapolis with Terrell Pryor, it's starting to look like, as their quarterback. Not a chance. Win for the Colts. Saints, Falcons. What a great matchup this one's going to be. I'm going to take New Orleans over Atlanta because Atlanta just can't seem to win in New Orleans. They get Sean Payton back. The defense is weakened from Atlanta, and the offense is going to be too strong for New Orleans. Expect it to be a shootout. Expect there to be at least a total of 70 points scored in that game. The Saints are going to win. The team with Darrelle Revis and the team that used to have Darrelle Revis and now has absolutely nobody. The Buccaneers are going to go in to MetLife to defeat the Jets in an easy one. Pittsburgh hosts Tennessee, and this is my upset pick for the week. Because as we said a couple weeks ago, Pittsburgh, whenever they play bad teams, it just seems like they're going through the motions. It's a perfect setup for Tennessee to come out inspired and defeat Pittsburgh in Heinz Field. Still in morning games, Seattle in Carolina. Let's take Russell Wilson over Cam Newton. The Seahawks are just going to be too much. Kansas City in Jacksonville. Normally this would be a cupcake matchup, but actually Kansas City's really good this year, and they're going to be too good for Jacksonville to defeat. Chiefs win on the road. St. Louis hosts Arizona. The Rams will get the win. That's an afternoon game. The only other afternoon game, the one that everyone's going to be watching, the Packers visit the 49ers, a rematch of last year's NFC Divisional Round playoff game, and week one of last year. The Niners won both of those matchups. I expect them to win again here. The Packers defense still isn't good enough. Although, if you're going to be watching that game, look out for Packers rookie, a defensive back by the name of Micah Hyde. He could be one of the best players that the organization has seen. They're really loving him, but it's just not going to be enough. I like the 49ers in that one. Sunday Night Football, Giants in Dallas. It's really the lesser of the two evils here. I don't know. It's just too much pressure for Dallas. I mean, with the whole Jerryville and the huge stadium. The Giants do well every other year, and I expect that pattern to continue. Let's go with New York. And the two Monday night games. Washington hosts Philadelphia. That's a tough one. RG3 or Michael Vick? I'm going to take RG3 just because I'm afraid that Philadelphia is going to turn the ball over too many times and they don't have enough targets. The second and final Monday night game. San Diego hosts Houston. The Chargers will keep it close, but it's not going to be enough. Houston's just too talented. Texans will win that game. And those are your picks from Rookies Roundup's Crystal Ball, your first edition, one down, 16 weeks to go. We're going to have another commercial coming right up, and after that, we will have our third guest of the night. The trivia question is, what is the most wins a team has gotten in a regular season in baseball history and still missed out in the playoffs? Think about it. We'll be right back from this commercial break.
Contact National Sports in a number of ways through Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter with the label National Sports. We love to have you guys a part of our show and can easily join us also through text or call. You're listening to the National Sports Radio Station on Spreaker.com. America's pastime.
Don't you wish it was still summertime? Welcome back to Rookies Roundup. The one good thing about not being summertime anymore, NFL season is back. If you've got something to say, if you've got an opinion, you've got a prediction, you want to be heard, call in at 310-922-9536 or leave a comment in the section below. We're going to have our third guest tonight. I'm going to contact him for the next about 30 seconds or sooner. Think about the trivia question. What's the most number of wins a team has gotten and still missed out in the playoffs? Here's a hint. It was before the wild card existed. Now we're going to call up our next guest. Bear with us and think about that trivia question for about 15 seconds. It's too bad I don't have that Jeopardy music. Note to self. Next show, cricket noises, Jeopardy music. It's going to be great. Hey, Jared Bacon, everybody. How you doing?
I'm good, Jake. How are you?
I am good. We got a big show tonight. I'm glad you can make it. So let's get right to it. Yeah, I know you're a baseball guy, and you know your baseball trivia. This is a tough one. Your trivia question is, because I've given a trivia question to every single guest tonight, your trivia question is, what is the most wins a team has gotten in the regular season without making the playoffs? Give me that number out of 162. And here's a hint, it was before the wild card era.
We're going to have to go with 94.
94 is the guess. Do you know that for a fact?
I don't, but I'm just going to take a guess. Somewhere around that range.
I can tell you that I am pretty sure, and I'm going to check this, that is not correct. I'll give you one more guess, I'll give you a hint. It's even more than 94.
Wow. 98?
The correct answer was 96. I believe I'm going to check up on that. Try to confirm that. Yeah, the Cincinnati Reds, I believe, had a 96-win season and still missed out on the playoffs. I'll look that up. Meanwhile, as I'm looking this up, here's the topic. NL Rookie of the Year. Yasiel Puig, the star-studded hitter for the Dodgers, or the pitcher from the Miami Marlins, Jose Fernandez. Hernandez, you know.
Have to go with Jose Fernandez.
Ooh, this should be good. Why Fernandez?
He's, well, he's been pitching great all year for the Marlins, and he's been their ace as a rookie, and he even made the All-Star team. He's just pitched really well. And I know that Puig started off really hot, but I mean, he's cooled down lately, and his mistakes are just too much. His base running mistakes, his not hitting the cutoff man, his attitude. These are all problems that are slowly building up, and I think they're going to be a huge problem for Puig as his career goes on.
Okay. So you're saying that it's a combination of an attitude problem for Puig and how good Fernandez is.
And also Puig's drop-off and how Fernandez has stayed consistent throughout the whole year.
That's fair enough. It's a good point. But when you look at Rookie of the Year, if you ask me, when you're handing out any awards, it's who is most valuable to their team. You mentioned that Jose Fernandez has been consistent and good all year. If he was worthy of a Rookie of the Year award, this team would not be where they were right now. And that's not his fault. He's a pitcher. That's just the way the position works. I don't care how amazing you are once every 5 years. Yasiel Puig, when he got there, he turned that team around. If Puig had never gotten there, we have no idea where the Dodgers were right now. I'm not saying that's just Puig, but it's not a coincidence either that this huge winning streak has started when Puig showed up.
That is true, but I still think that Hernandez has pitched a lot better. If you look at my favorite advanced baseball statistic, WAR, you have Jose Fernandez with a 5.4, which means that he is above all-star quality and around all-star quality. Where if you look at Puig, which is around a 4.4, and it's not even all-star quality. And when you look at Puig's stats right now, in less than 350 plate appearances, He has 75 strikeouts. That's a lot, and that's way too many for a hitter of his caliber. When you look at Hernandez, he has a 2.33 ERA, and he has 173 strikeouts in not even 160 innings. And he just pitched really well for this Marlins team. And even though the Marlins team isn't a very good team, you know that every fifth day when Hernandez gets the ball, you're going to get a good start out.
It's a lot easier to be a consistent team, or consistent player, excuse me, when you're going out once every 5 days, though. I mean, Puig can't be as consistent. And first of all, let me tell you something about WAR. You're a numbers guy. I appreciate statistics, and I do believe in the numbers, but I draw the line at WAR. And here's why I stopped believing in WAR. Because according to that, Mike Trout should have won the MVP last year over Miguel Cabrera, who hit for the triple crown. And that's ridiculous. There is no way Trout deserved to win that MVP. If we listen to WAR, it's going to take us in the wrong direction, just like the direction you want to take us here with Hernandez. There are certain things that you cannot measure on paper, and that is all what Puig is about. His energy, the excitement he's brought into this team. It's turned the Dodgers around. He has completely turned the Dodgers around, and you can't put that in numbers. Consistency, it's an issue because it's just not fair. Hernandez goes out once every 5 games. It's a lot easier for him to be consistent. Puig has gone there day in, day out, and has given maximum effort, and a vast majority of the time has come through big time for this team.
Yes, but when you say that Hernandez goes out once every 5th day, you're being a little biased towards pitchers, and you're preferring these hitters, because that's what a starting pitcher does. They come out once every 5th day, and they're expected to go 6, 7, 8 innings and give up 2, 3 runs. That's just how they're supposed to pitch. But with Puig, a position player, he's supposed to come out every day and play. So you can't really compare the pitcher to the hitter in that aspect. You can really compare how they perform. Sure, the Dodgers went on a crazy winning streak once Puig came to the team. But also, Jaime Ramirez came off the DL at that same time. You can't just put it on Puig.
I didn't say it was just put...
just turning this whole team around.
It's not just Puig. That's correct. But this did all start when Puig came in. Am I being biased against pitchers? Absolutely. I think there's nothing Hernandez can do about it. He's done great for the position he's in. But when you have a guy like Puig that's turned a team around, like the Dodgers, and then you have Hernandez, who's been great, he still only gets to be great once every 5 days. It's just the position, if you ask me, that Hernandez is in. If he wasn't a pitcher, I'd consider it. I'm not saying that pitchers are worthless. I'm saying when it comes to this award, it is a disadvantage, because you only get to go out there once every 5 days. You see what I'm saying?
Yes, but also with Puig, too, you have to look at his base running. 10 stolen bases, he's been caught 8 times. And then think of the countless other times that he's been doubled off or thrown out of the base because of his bad base running. How can you be such a valuable player to your team and be the rookie of the year if you're costing your team outs, you're costing your team's runs? And even the Dodgers team, there are only a few wins, you're costing your team wins.
He's costing this team wins. Is that what are you saying? Yasiel Puig is costing this team wins. The same team that was last place in the NL West and went to first in just a month. You know where they are now? They are 82-55. They are 12.5 games ahead of second place in the NL West. It's not all Puig, but don't give me that Puig's costing this team wins. The Dodgers have Puig to thank for a lot more wins than he's given up.
They do have Puig to thank for when they got started on this run, but now that they've been on this run for a while, Puig has started to taper off. Pitchers have figured out that he likes the chase. They're exploiting that. That's what brings up the 75 strikeouts. Puig is just too good of a hitter not to be able to make these adjustments quickly, and that's why he doesn't deserve to be the rookie of the year, because he's not able to make the adjustments and continue playing on a consistent basis throughout the whole year.
Knowing me and you, we could go back and forth for days when it comes to this. For the good of both of us, I think we're going to have to stop that right there. We'll see who wins. I think it should be Puig. You think it should be Hernandez. I'm not sure how much I trust WAR. Who knows? We'll see. Now, tonight is the NFL prediction special. Who is winning the NFC championship?
Well, I'm going to have to go with the Seattle Seahawks. They're just too good of a team with their defense. And so a lot of people say that the 49ers are going to win the NFC West, but look at what happened last year. The Seahawks completely came out of nowhere to shock the 49ers. And the Seahawks can do it again this year. They have the talent. They have a mobile quarterback that can throw and run. So do the 49ers and Kaepernick. But, however, their advantage is their defense, their pass defense. Sure, the 49ers have a great defense, but that Seahawks defense is just too good to not win this NFC with a lot of good offensive teams, poor defenses. The Seahawks can stop these offenses, and they will win this NFC championship.
Yeah, you know who the Seahawks remind me of, and I said this a few times on this show, they remind me of the Packers team a couple years ago that won the Super Bowl, in terms of defense. A team with a tenacious pass rush, in this case it's led by Cliff Avril, and a secondary that wreaks havoc and knows how to force turnovers. When you can force the team, when you can force turnovers, when you can get the ball more often than the other team, when you can score more often than the other team. At the end of the day, in football, it's very simple. Whichever team has more points on the board at the end of the day wins. And Seattle does a very good job of making sure that the other team does not get as many points as they do. It's a very simple and dumbed-down explanation, but it still holds true. The Seahawks are a very basic team that's got a modern twist working for them. And I agree with you. Seattle is better than San Francisco and can win the NFC. What about the AFC? And you are a Patriot fan. I have to give that disclaimer. It's always tough. We've heard the Bengals' name being tossed around a little bit. The previous two guys who were on the show both said Denver was going to go to the Super Bowl. What about you?
Well, I am a little biased toward the Patriots, but I try to be as fair-minded as possible. But the Patriots are just too good this year. Even though they did lose a bunch of wide receivers, they're still a great team. For the first time in a while, they actually have a run game. When they won these Super Bowls, they had great running backs. And, you know, they have a third down running back by the name of Shane Vereen, and he reminds me a lot of a Patriots legend, Kevin Falk. It's those third down conversions that win games. When you have a third and three, third and four, you need to convert that to move the chain and keep drive going so you can score points. And with Vereen there, he's a great pass catcher that can get the short passes and fight for those extra yards. And so what, the Patriots lost Wes Welker. They got Danny Amendola to replace him. They still have Rob Gronkowski, even though he'll be injured for the first few weeks, including the cupcake game against Buffalo, which we should definitely destroy Buffalo in that game. Especially with Jeff Toole expected to start, because DJ Manuel, even though he has returned to practice, I don't think he'll be ready for Sunday's game.
All right, listen. Just because you beat the Bills, led by Jeff Toole, does not make you a Super Bowl team. Let me tell you something. To compare Shane Vereen to Kevin Falk is a slap in the face to Kevin Falk. Vereen still has to prove himself. So don't even throw Falk's name in there. Here's my problem with New England. Gronkowski has had so many health issues. If he can't stay healthy, this team is done. They've lost too many targets on offense if Gronkowski goes up. And second, the disciplinary issues. I know I'm not talking about Hernandez, because I do have faith in Bill Belichick that he can handle these situations well. But guys like Aqib Talib, with all this going around him, I mean, do you really trust him to stay out of trouble? If you look at what he's done.
Yeah, during the season, I definitely trust him to stay out of trouble. When you think about it, all of Gronk's troubles have been in the offseason when there is no football. So I think that both him and Talib will be able to stay focused during the season. And Belichick does a great job of controlling his players. That's why I think the Patriots are, in fact, the Super Bowl team. They're good enough to win the Super Bowl. They have the star quarterback that you need. They have the running game. They may not have the best receivers, but they have solid receivers that have all played really well in the preseason. And one thing that you're forgetting right now is undrafted free agent Zach Sudfeld. He has been huge in the preseason, and he is very similar to Gronk. No, he's not even close to being as good as Gronk, but his body type is the exact same, and he is a great red zone target while Gronk is out. And
And then even though the defense isn't the greatest defense in the world, they still have a solid enough defense to win games and win the Super Bowl. They have Vince Wilfork, Rob Ninkovich, Chandler Jones, and now with the addition of Tommy Kelly up front, that's a great front four. And then they have Gerard Mayo, Brandon Spikes, you know, at linebacker. Then they have Tlaib, they have Devin McCourty at safety, okay. Tlaib at corner, Kyle Arrington at corner. They're very solid on defense, and they're able to win games.
Let's just talk about Aqib Tlaib and everything that's gone around him. And here's why I think it's more likely that Aqib Tlaib is going to be in jail by the end of this season than the Patriots will win the Super Bowl. August 2009, Tlaib allegedly battered a taxi driver and was arrested by Florida Highway Patrol and booked into county jail for resisting arrest without violence and simple battery. March in Texas, Texas issued a felony warrant for Tlaib for aggravated assault with a deadly weapon after accusing him of firing a gun at his sister's boyfriend. He was later released on $25,000 bond and then was indicted on the charge in May. And in June of 2012, they were dropped because of insufficient evidence and character concerns with the accuser. This man's gotten into a lot of trouble. And here's the other reason. Of everything that you have said to me about the New England Patriots, and here's why I'm not sold on this argument. You cannot argue that a team is going to make a Super Bowl without once mentioning the quarterback. You did not say Tom Brady's name once. It used to be, and they have Tom Brady. He's the best quarterback in the league. He's the reason that they'll lead us to a Super Bowl. Brady's not what he used to be anymore. This team, there's so many other teams in the AFC on the rise. You've got the Texans. You've got the Bengals. You've got the Broncos. When the Broncos play the Patriots and it turns into a shootout, the Broncos will blow them out of the water if you look at their receiving core.
That is true, but I mean, if you look at Brady, he is getting better. So let's look at it for a second. So he throws for over 4,800 yards last year, 34 touchdowns, and 8 interceptions. He's been over 30 touchdown passes for the past 3 years. And he's been getting older. And he's still staying the Tom Brady that he is. He knows how to lead the team. The New England Patriots team runs more plays than any other team in football just because he's so great at running the no-huddle offense. He's great at controlling the team. And yes, all the young quarterbacks you're talking about, these are all read-option quarterbacks. You don't have to be a read-option quarterback to succeed in the NFL now. You can still be the pocket passer that Brady is and lead your team to Super Bowl. He is a good enough passer to do that, and the Patriots are a good enough team to beat anybody in the AFC and the NFC in the Super Bowl.
But so is Peyton Manning. Some could say that so is Andy Dalton. That's not just the read option quarterbacks that threaten you. And when you're talking about how many touchdown passes Brady has thrown, if we look at Wes Welker, how many touchdowns he caught? Of those 30-plus touchdowns he threw in the past 3 seasons, Welker caught 7, 9, and 6 touchdowns, respectively, in each of those seasons. That's a lot of touchdowns and a lot of points that go down the drain. You've lost Welker. Amendola can't fill the void that Welker left.
Well, I'd like to point out something about Danny Amendola. If you compare Danny Amendola and Wes Welker, they are almost exactly the same type of player. Wes Welker came to the Patriots the same age as Amendola, same university, Texas Tech, and they both had similar stats prior to joining the Patriots. That's where I think Amendola will be more than ready to fill the void. He's done his work in the offseason. He's ready to go, and he has learned this offense. And Tom Brady, he knows how to throw the ball. If you're open, he sees you, and he will find you the ball, and you will be able to catch it and score. That's just how the Patriots' offense is going to work. And now when you have the running game with Stephen Ridley, once you establish him, you can start running play action. Once you do that, you can start doing everything a lot better and more efficiently and have a great offense.
I have a great offense, but you know what they say. Defense wins championships, which brings me to my next question. Is it enough for the Patriots to win, or would the Seahawks be too much to handle? Keep in mind, last year the Seahawks and the Patriots met. Seattle came away with the win there. This time it'll be played in a likely snowy weather game in New York for Super Bowl 48. Who wins, and why?
Well, I'm going to have to go with the Patriots just because they're a slightly better team than the Seahawks. Do you know that the Seahawks have a great defense? Tom Brady knows how to pick apart defense. He will find a way to win this game. Sure, Russell Wilson will be great, and he can run through the Patriots' defense. But people don't understand Tom Brady is a competitor. He would be studying hours and hours and hours of film throughout the whole day, and he will know how to find holes in the Seattle defense. You think about it, by the time the Super Bowl comes around, they'll have about 18 weeks of film on the Seahawks team. So they'll be able to study the defense every week and what kind of schemes they use. And Brady and Josh McDaniels, the offensive coordinator, will be able to find ways to exploit the holes in Seattle's defense and patch up the holes in their defense. Belichick will do that. And the Patriots will just find a way to win the game because that's what the New England Patriots do.
That's what they used to do. Seattle's also going to have 18 weeks of film as well. You would have thought that this was the Patriots' game to win last year. Let's take a look. Seattle won that game 24-3. With less than 10 minutes to go, New England was winning that game 23-10. What's stopping Seattle from winning that way again? And I'm sure the Patriots are very good with studying film and acquiring film. Ask the New York Jets about that. They know what it's like to have their film studied. I don't care how much film you study. When it comes to the Super Bowl, just because you put in the hours and watch tape doesn't leave room for the intangibles and what could happen. And they've lost the clutch gene. The Patriots are no longer clutch. The Patriots used to be that team that could win and beat the odds. Not anymore. And the Seahawks proved that last year. And who was the leading receiver that game for the Patriots? Wes Welker had 10 receptions, 138 yards, and a touchdown for that game. And now he's gone. Even with Welker, they still lost. What's stopping Seattle from defeating New England again?
Well, what's stopping them is that the Patriots played really poorly in that game. Brady got sacked 7 times in that game. Brady also threw 2 interceptions. One time for 7 yards, and he threw 2 interceptions, and he did not complete enough passes. He threw for 58 passes. The Patriots don't want to have to do that again. They only have 26 carries. They're going to try to up that number to around 30, 35, 40 carries, and they only had 87 yards, and they averaged 3 yards per rushing attempt. They need to be able to get more than that out of Stephen Ridley and Shane Green and even Brandon Bolden. And let's face it, LeGarrette Blount is a huge addition in the red zone. He will be a great power back for them. And even with the loss of Wes Welker, they'll still be able to make up for it. There's other ways to win this game. And also, Jake, I really do not appreciate your reference to the Scott Spygate scandal.
Okay, well, I'm sure the Jets didn't appreciate that scandal either, but tough cookies. All right, I'll give you the Patriots. If you think that, that's fine. I don't think it's going to happen. We'll see. We will see. Imagine that. The Patriots win the Super Bowl because they start to run the ball. I find it hard to believe. But you are a Patriots fan, and no one knows the Patriots like you do. So I'll give you that. One last question. Which playoff team from last year is ready to disappoint this year?
I think that the team most likely to disappoint this year, I think, probably going to be the Indianapolis Colts. Even though I think that they'll still make the playoffs, it won't be in the dramatic fashion that they did last year with Andrew Luck. I think they'll struggle this year, and as I was on last week, breaking down the AFC South, I think they will make the playoffs. But I think fans will be really disappointed at not beating the Texans and just struggling in general. They're not going to play as great as they did last year. They're not going to go far in the playoffs as fans want them to. That's why I think the Colts are going to disappoint.
So you're saying that it's a disappointment. Even though that they'll finish the same way they did last year, it'll be a disappointment because there will be higher expectations.
Exactly. And they're not going to be able to meet those expectations because they're unrealistically high.
I agree with you there. I don't know if the Colts still have that fire, and I think that they very easily could disappoint. Jared, thank you for being on the show. I sincerely hope that you are wrong about the Patriots winning the Super Bowl, but I appreciate you coming on nonetheless. Jared Bacon, everyone. See ya. All right. Three topics down. One more topic to go. Of course, so our last guest contacted me a little while ago. He said that he's coming home from somewhere and he's not going to be able to make it to the show until 9:30, which means we have 20 minutes to kill. And there's so much to talk about. We could even do our awards early. But there's more to it. Because we've been talking about opinions this whole show, but we're missing one very important opinion. And that's my opinion. Here's what I think. And since we have 20 minutes to kill, I'll give you details. I'll tell you everyone that's going to go to the playoffs, how it's going to break down. And you may have heard this before, I've made some changes. Because there are just those pesky injuries that come in the preseason that turn things around. There are changes of heart. So here's the final prediction. In the NFC, number one will be Seattle and number two will be Green Bay. Those two teams will get the bye. I think Seattle, once again, is a lot better than San Francisco. I think the Niners could disappoint this year. Number three. I know I said that the New Orleans Saints would win that division. But I told you about injuries and I told you about changes of heart. It's naive of me if I looked over the huge issue that is the New Orleans Saints defense, especially without Will Smith now. So by default, I will give that division to the Falcons and put them in as a 3 seed. As a 4 seed, I'm still going to stick with the New York Giants winning that division. And again, just kind of by default, I think there are too many injuries with the Eagles to keep their good fortunes up. I think that Alfred Morris is going to be a disappointment this year for the Redskins. And I think that the Dallas Cowboys, even though I do like Tony Romo, are going to disappoint yet again. He's not good enough in the clutch. I'll give the 4 seed to the Giants. Number 5 will be the San Francisco 49ers, and grabbing the last spot, even if their defense is weak, it's enough to get them to the playoffs, the New Orleans Saints. Those are the 6 playoff teams I've got in the NFC. In the AFC, number 1 will be the Denver Broncos. Number 2 will be the New England Patriots. Those two will each get byes, no surprise there. And then you've got the AFC North. And the AFC South. Number 3, I'm going to give to the Cincinnati Bengals, because I think that the AFC North as a division is going to get weaker this year. The Steelers and the Ravens are going to disappoint. And number 4, the winner of the AFC South, will be the Houston Texans, the wild card teams. Number 5 goes to the Kansas City Chiefs, and number 6 goes to the Miami Dolphins. NFC, wild card round. The number 3 seeded... Number 3 seed. Help me out here. Who was the number 3 seed? I'm just kidding. I'm stalling because I'm thirsty and I need some water. But we can't stop here. You know, take commercial breaks for no reason. Thirsty or not, we will continue. My number 3 seed in the NFC was the Atlanta Falcons. They would host my number 6 seed, the New Orleans Saints. I will give that to Atlanta because they've lost so many playoff games already. And again, I'm pretty sure it's an Aerosmith lyric. You have to know how to lose to know how to win. And the Falcons definitely know how to lose when it comes to the playoffs. Atlanta advances. Number 4 versus number 5, the Giants and the Niners. A rematch of 2 years ago in the NFC Championship. This time they meet in the wild card. Just because you make the playoffs and win the NFC East does not mean that you're good enough. That's going to be the case here. Another early exit for an NFC East team. It'll be a lot closer than most people think. Never count the Giants out when it comes to the playoffs. As a Packer fan, I've learned that lesson the hard way multiple times. I give it to the Niners. To the AFC we go. Number 3 versus number 6. Houston hosts Miami. And you want to talk about a fun matchup. That's going to be a great matchup. I think And my gut's telling me that I shouldn't be saying this. But my head is saying it's the right call. I think the Texans are going to win a very tight one. Houston defeats Miami. The Dolphins are on the way up, though. Don't overlook that. Number 4 versus number 5, we will see the... Oh, I'm sorry. Number 3 is the Cincinnati Bengals. Cincinnati Bengals play the Dolphins, but nonetheless, I still like the Bengals in that game. Number 4 versus number 5, it's going to be Houston this time, for real. Houston versus Kansas City. And that is the game that Kansas City will win, because I've given Houston too many chances when it comes to the playoffs, and they have disappointed every single time. Kansas City matches up too well with Houston. The defense is going to give the Chiefs the win in that game. Back to the NFC. Division round games. Because the Niners are worse as a 5 seed than the 3 seed Falcons, they will go on to play the number 1 Seattle Seahawks. The Seahawks and the Niners meet again. I said it a month ago, and I am still staying with that prediction. For the third time that year, Seattle defeats San Francisco, and this time it's the knockout punch. Seahawks advance. They're just too good at home. We saw the last time they played in Seattle, 42-13. Seahawks won that game. The numbers don't lie, unless those numbers are war. Number 2, Green Bay Packers. They will host the Atlanta Falcons. The Packers don't seem to come through when they play playoff games at home. The year they won the Super Bowl did not play a single playoff game at home. A rematch between the Packers and the Falcons. Once again, they meet in the divisional round. When the Packers won the Super Bowl, it was a 1-6, and Green Bay won that game. Green Bay will finally win the playoff game at home, and it will set up an epic battle for the NFC Championship between the Seattle Seahawks and the Green Bay Packers. AFC. The number 1 Denver Broncos face the number 5 Kansas City Chiefs. Now, I'm trying not to get it over my head here, but the 9-11 record in the playoffs still bothers me when it comes to the Broncos. The problem with Kansas City is, even with Alex Smith, I don't look at that team and say, this team is strong enough offensively to overpower a bad defense in Denver. But, considering the Broncos' defense is so bad, and Manning finds a way to lose in the playoffs all the time, I can't believe I'm saying this. I like Kansas City in that one. I like Kansas City going into Denver. I think this will be the third time they play each other. They'll know each other well. Kansas City will know what to do. Don't forget about Alex Smith. Alex Smith is already lost in a playoff run. He's going to be hungry. Dwayne Bowe, Jamal Charles, it's a strong offensive unit against a very weak defensive unit, and that's going to be the key. Kansas City Chiefs, I can't believe I'm saying it, it's still crazy to me, go to the AFC Championship game. Who will they face? Either the Patriots or the Bengals? The Patriots have seemed to take their eye off the ball in the past few years. No matter how good the Belichick-Brady combination is, the Bengals are a young team. The Bengals are on the rise. And for a very long time, I thought that the Bengals would win the AFC. I thought that this was going to be a big year for Cincinnati. With AJ Green, with Andy Dalton, with Ben Jarvis Green Ellis. But when you actually say it out loud, the Bengals defeat the Patriots in New England, it's just not right. It's not right. The Patriots deserve better than that. They have earned my respect. I think Cincinnati's going to have to go through some more playoff experience to learn their lesson. The Patriots advance. Final 4, New England versus Kansas City. Seattle versus Green Bay. Oh boy, it's like Christmas morning just a few weeks after. In Seattle, the Seahawks host the Packers. The Packers have very bitter memories of CenturyLink Field. Every Packer fan does too, and they will be so hungry, and they will be so ready for battle. But That was still a game when Seattle got to Aaron Rodgers to sack him 8 different times. The Seahawks do something that the Packers don't. They cover all their bases. So for the real win, the Seahawks will defeat the Packers in the NFC Championship game to go to the Super Bowl. I am hoping against hope that it doesn't happen, but I think it is. New England versus Kansas City. The Patriots win. The Patriots win games, and even if they're not as clutch as they used to be, even with Alex Smith wanting revenge, I still take the Patriots in this one. Because Gronkowski is going to be healthy. I really like Amendola. So I'm going to take New England moving on to the Super Bowl. Seattle and New England in the Super Bowl. I talked about this with Jared for a little bit. And everybody who has come onto this show has agreed. The Seattle Seahawks cover all their bases. When a team does not have a kryptonite, when a team does not have a weak spot, when a team has proven they can win even though they are young, when a team is designed for modern football, like the Seattle Seahawks, I hate to preach for them. I hate to be impressed with them. It's sickening for me. But they've earned my respect. They demand the respect of every team in the NFL. Seattle will defeat New England, and the Seahawks will be the Super Bowl champions. It's official. Again, hoping against hope that it doesn't happen. I would so rather be wrong in this case than right. It's a rare occurrence, but that's the case here. And the team that's going to disappoint? Not the Baltimore Ravens. Hello? Did everybody just seem to forget about them? They did win the Super Bowl. They are the defending champs. And they're really going to disappoint when they find that they go 8-8 this season. Ravens miss the playoffs. Other former playoff teams that aren't going to return. The Washington Redskins, the Indianapolis Colts. Who else do I think is not going to make the playoffs again? The Minnesota Vikings. That's 4. Anybody else? Anybody else? I don't think so. I think that's it. Yep. 4 teams from last year's playoffs will not return there again. You heard it here first. My Super Bowl prediction, Super Bowl 48, Seahawks over Patriots. Team that's going to disappoint, Baltimore Ravens. We are going to take a quick break. I am finally going to get my water. We'll be right back. We'll have our final guest of the day. We're still going here. I'm looking at the clock. We have been going for an hour and 23 minutes strong. I don't know how we're doing it, but we are pulling this off. We will be right back after our final commercial break of the night. Stay with us. It's the final topic, the one you don't want to miss. Is there a future for Tim Tebow? We'll be right back.
Hi, this is Sam Rosen, and I'm here with Sam's Situation.
Good afternoon, and welcome into the corner. It's Chris's Corner here on Spreaker.com, a national sports affiliate.
Hello, and welcome to the Cameron Sadeghi Show.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another edition of the Deep Sports Hockey. This is affiliated with National Sports.
Cameron Sadeghi, Chris Sylvester, Sam Rosen, Andrew Goldstein, Daniel Levy, and the entire broadcast crew. With Commissioner Robert Dieters, you are live from National Sports Radio Station in Los Angeles, California.
It's our party weekend. got some sweaty bodies everywhere. Hands in the air like we don't care. Cause we came to have so much fun now. Somebody here might get some now. If you're ready to go home, can I get a hell no? Cause we gonna go all night till we see the sunlight. All
I had to play Miley Cyrus there. I figured it was very appropriate considering all the polarizing figures we're talking about tonight. And because we cannot stop. We are nearly an hour and a half into this show, and it is just my sixth episode of ever doing a radio broadcast. I'm having that 2:30 feeling. It's like those five-hour energy commercials, only it's happening at more at like 9:30. But what keeps me awake? Sports. Thinking about it, talking about it, and who gets people's minds going more than Tim Tebow? We're going to have that coming up next. You've heard our picks this far. We've heard someone say that the Niners will win. We've heard someone say the Patriots will win. We've heard someone say that the Seahawks will win. We've heard me say the Seahawks will win. What do the experts think? Well, just like Jared said, Sports Illustrated's Peter King believes that the New England Patriots will win in the Super Bowl over Seattle in a tight contest. I believe he said the score was 27-24. I am going to check on that right now. Now, oddly enough, ESPN, the magazine, went with more of a numbers approach. Final score for, according to Peter King of Sports Illustrated, Patriots 30, Seattle Seahawks 23, Patriots win. ESPN, the magazine, used an algorithm to predict the final score of every single game that would be played this season. Their final result was one that raised eyebrows, to say the least. For the AFC, I'll give you the scores because they're in front of me. Texans over the Ravens 24-3. Dolphins over the Chiefs 20-13. Those were the wild card games. The Texans would defeat the Bengals 37-20, and the Broncos would defeat the Dolphins 41-28. Now, I named six teams there. Guess who's missing? The Patriots. According to ESPN Magazine, the New England Patriots will finish 9-7 and not even make the playoffs. We'll see how that turns out. So they say that the Texans and the Broncos will face off in the AFC Championship game, and Peyton will come through. Final score, Denver 24, Houston 14. Denver goes to the Super Bowl. On the NFC side, the wild card games. Falcons defeat the Bucks 45-10. Niners defeat the Redskins 19-13. The Niners will go on to play Seattle. The Falcons will go on to play Green Bay. Just like I said. And that continues. The Packers defeat the Falcons 31-24. The Seahawks defeat the Niners 23-21. NFC Championship game, Seattle and Green Bay. Who wins? They continue to agree with me. Seattle over Green Bay 28-24. Which leaves Denver versus Seattle in the Super Bowl, and they go with the Denver Broncos at the final score of 34-31. Very interesting. Everyone's got ideas. You've got ideas, you've got predictions and opinions. Hit me up here at Rookies Roundup. Leave a comment, call us up at 310-922-9536, or leave a comment in the section below. Now, we're going to try and start a new tradition here, because the NFL season is starting. We're going to take a play that happened in recent years in the same week that's coming up. So, the best week one play I can remember in memory. Do you remember in 2009? When the Broncos, or was this week two? No, it was week one. The Broncos are playing the Bengals in Cincinnati. 28 seconds left. It's been a sloppy game. Cincinnati leads Denver 7-6. The Broncos have the ball at their own 18-yard line with 28 seconds left and no timeouts, trailing by one. Their quarterback is Kyle Orton. Listen to the call on CBS. We're still waiting for that to load. Here we go. Not this second me out again. Yeah, I'm giving up on it. See? I told you. Don't trust the Broncos. Well, hopefully we can get that clip for you later on. Oh, here we go.
Ball downfield. Snap on second down. Four-man rush. Horton pumps once. Throws. Pass is going to be tipped. And caught! Stokely's got it! Here we go! 40! 35! 30! 25! 20! 15! 10! 5! Toby House! Holy cow! Brandon Stokely! Are you kidding me? Are you...
Yep, that's right. The deep pass down the sidelines from Kyle Orton is tipped. It falls into Stokely's hands. He cuts upfield. Touchdown. Broncos win in week one, 13-7. That means all we've got left is our final guest and, of course, our three awards. What will those be? I'm going to see if I can contact the guy who... Your mystery guest. It's a secret. Don't tell anybody. Oh, God. It's live. If you can't tell, as I continue to go on, fill up as much airtime as I can. The show must go on. But I'm still impressed, you know? We are now officially 91 minutes and 46 seconds and counting into the show. While I wait to get contact from our final guest, we are going to give the final three awards. Here we go. MVP, you might have heard about this. Maybe it's technically sports related. It's an athletic feat. So there's the 64-year-old one. I'm sure you've heard about it already. For those of you who haven't, prepare to be shocked. Oh, I got him on the phone. We do get to wait till the end. You are about to have your name revealed. Carl, you are our fourth and final guest. How you doing?
I'm doing good.
Still cold up there in Oregon?
It is absolutely beautiful and promising you better than the weather in Green Bay.
I can definitely agree with you on that one. Luckily, I live in LA, so it's nice here, too. Let's get right to it. You are our fourth and final guest, and we get to talk about our fourth and final topic. Tim Tebow was recently cut by the New England Patriots. Is there still a future for this guy in the NFL? What do you think?
I have one word for you. Jacksonville. The thing is, Blaine Gabbert is about as good as an NFL quarterback as Tim Tebow is, but Tim Tebow will sell tickets there. And Jacksonville has nothing to look forward to in the next 3 years or so. So why not take him as a publicity stunt and basically get some money out of the revenue, and he'll easily sell the tickets that his contract's worth.
All right. Well, at least someone agrees with me that there's still a future for this guy in the NFL. But I can tell you that's not in Jacksonville. Because the entire organization, I'm not saying that you're wrong, I'm just saying that the entire organization has a lot of faith in Blaine Gabbert. They've taken the number-crunching route here, and apparently when you crunch the numbers, it somehow makes Blaine Gabbert look good, and they have hope there. I think it's wishful thinking, and I think Jacksonville would benefit from that.
I would love to see them crunch those numbers and see where they, you know, forgot to carry their two or something.
Yeah, apparently there's something like, you know, when he's in the pocket, he has a really good QB rating. I don't know. I think that he deserves a future in the NFL, and I think he'll still get one. He's better than a lot of the starting quarterbacks we're going to see. I would take Tim Tebow over Jeff Toole. I would take Tim Tebow over Brandon Bean, okay. And I would take him over to Al Brown. Yeah?
You can't go on Jeff Toole, though, because Jeff Toole is not a real starting. I mean,
That's true.
He's going to start one, two games. You would have to say you're taking him over Kevin Cobb, E.J. Manuel, who I like E.J. Manuel.
Yeah, I do too. I see what you're saying. But still, I mean, on the Browns, on the Raiders, where the future is so bleak, I mean, what's the worst that could happen if you bring in Tebow? You know, it would be interesting if, like, the Packers brought him to play in, like, alongside Randall Cobb in the slot. You know, someone should turn him into a wide receiver. That's where his future is.
Well, you look at him and maybe the place for, you know, like, Denard Robinson. He went off and he got drafted, and I believe it was by, like, Jacksonville or a team like that.
It was.
He was when he was drafted, he went to the combine as a wide receiver. He knew his place. He knew he was a freak athlete, but he needed to be doing it. He's listed as an offensive weapon as his position originally. Like, on the website of his team, he was listed as an offensive weapon. He's not just a wide receiver, I think, but he knew his place. He was a quarterback, but now he's finding his place as an athlete who can make plays on the football field and be effective.
I was at the UCLA football game on Saturday night, and as we were driving home, we were listening to this radio show, and they were talking about Tim Tebow. And this guy called in, and he said, Tim Tebow definitely deserves to have a spot in this league. All he has ever done is win. And that's why I realized I liked Tim Tebow. Do you know that Tim Tebow is the only player ever to win a Heisman Trophy in college and a playoff game in the NFL? He knows how to win games. He's proven himself. The way the Broncos treated him was pathetic. The way the Jets treated him was pathetic. He had a fair shot with the Patriots. He wasn't good enough, but why they played him as a quarterback. If someone tries him out as a wide receiver, I think he can succeed in this league.
I think he's a little too big for a wide receiver, but it seems like going in his hand. But I look at him, the Jets gave him like 40 snaps all year. They didn't let him play quarterback.
Yeah, you want
they took him and put him as a backup. They didn't really touch him, and I really think the Jets made a huge mistake on that one because they took a quarterback who has a chance and decided he wasn't good enough, so they used him as a publicity stunt.
Yeah, I blame that one on Rex Ryan. Because I think they'd be a lot better right now if they have Tim Tebow, because at least Tebow could win games. And that's not what the Jets are going to be doing this season. We're
no,
pressed for
time. Tebow finds a way. Tebow finds a way. Also, are you sure on that Heisman one? And second of all,
I am positive.
RG3 will probably change that. RG3 will change that in 1 or 2 years.
I agree.
Or Cam Newton, either one of them.
I agree. I am absolutely 1,000% positive about that Tebow stat, and I do think you're right about RG3. We are nearing the 100-minute mark, which certainly means we are getting low on time. So, let's move on. Before I ask you for your Super Bowl pick, I've given every single guest a trivia question. They'll get two guesses to answer it correctly. Of the three guests, only one has answered correctly, and that was on the second try. My trivia question for you is, who is the only player in the history of the Madden series to avoid the Madden curse completely?
I'm trying to think through all the cover athletes and what happened with them. Okay, so I know Larry Fitzgerald.
Larry Fitzgerald is correct on the very first try. That is cool.
Yep. That's what you get from playing video games way too much.
And even then, he shared the cover, so Paul Amalu took the bullet
for him. Yeah, exactly. So each cover has an athlete who will get it.
Yeah. We'll see. I mean, you're a Viking fan. I know you're praying that that doesn't stay true with Adrian Peterson on the cover for, like, the PS4 games.
It won't. Adrian Peterson avoids curses at all costs. It comes with being Purple Jesus. He gets to avoid that thing.
Purple Jesus.
You've never heard that one?
That's a true thing.
It's because he's a Viking figure.
We're talking about Tim Tebow, and you mentioned Jesus. We're actually not talking about Tebow anymore. I'm just saying it's ironic. I'm saying it's completely ironic that we're talking about Jesus, and it's not about Tim Tebow, but it's about the purple Jesus, Adrian Peterson.
But you know who would you rather have, Adrian Peterson or Tim Tebow as your savior? You know, it goes back to that.
All right. So, purple Jesus can avoid mad curses is the verdict. Now, your Super Bowl prediction. Who wins the NFC and why?
NFC, let's go. I still love the 49ers. I hate to pick the favorite, and I feel like it's kind of stupid to pick the favorite, because the favorite almost never does it, and the 49ers are so fast. They didn't lose much. I mean, they did lose Crabtree, but they're just so stacked, and RG3, if they can make it to the NFC Championship game...
RG3? Are we talking about the Niners?
Not RG3, it's not a Kaepernick. Okay. Sorry. Well, I get stuck with my, you know, read offense quarterback. Sorry. Okay. Colin Kaepernick is such a big upgrade from Alex Smith. Plus, they did have a pretty good draft cycle. They didn't lose anybody. They're not that old of a team. All they're doing is getting better. And, of course, they still got Harbaugh at the helm. I just don't see anybody beating them.
Right.
Except the Seahawks. The Seahawks is the only other team I could see touching them in the NFC, especially. Yeah, I just don't see anybody else being able to come out of the NFC. But most likely 49ers. 49ers don't make it out of the Seahawks.
Yeah, it's interesting because of the five people on this show that have been on the show and shared their predictions, including me. Three have said Seattle, two have said San Francisco. I also just went over the Sports Illustrated and ESPN picks. They also both had Seattle in the NFC. Here's why I'm worried with San Francisco. They had an element of surprise last year with Colin Kaepernick. Now they're bringing in a bunch of star players. It's too many cooks in the kitchen is my problem. Last year, when San Francisco and Seattle played, when they played in San Francisco, the Niners won that game 13-6, skated away by the skin of their teeth. When the game was played in Seattle, the Seahawks crushed them 42-13. I think that San Francisco's a good team. I think the only reason they're not going to the Super Bowl is because Seattle's better.
Yeah, I mean, again, it's that NFC West. The surprise is a good division to be that. The two best teams in the NFC, plus the Cardinals will be better with Carson Palmer. And then the Rams are weirdly going to be okay this year.
I agree. I'm excited about Darryl Richardson. I think he's going to be a delightful surprise. He'll be a pleasant surprise, if you ask me.
Yeah. Alright, so should we move on to the AFC then?
We
don't know who's gonna win the NFC out of the two teams.
Because
the AFC is weirdly open, isn't it?
Yeah, no one really can peg the AFC this year. I mean, you want to go with the Broncos and the Patriots, but you've also got the Bengals in the mix, and then you've got the Chiefs on the rise.
Chiefs won't make it. They're not gonna come back that fast. I'll just tell you that. Because the Chiefs will make, but that's a different argument completely. When I look at the AFC, I don't like the Patriots because I just don't. I think they get overhyped every year now. Since they were called the dynasty and stuff, they get pushed over that. Broncos, Peyton worries me. He just is injured, and you have Von Miller out for a few games, and he's just such a force on that line. I don't like the Broncos. I honestly have to go with the Texans. I think
what?
Their defense is The Texans, a team that can't win in the playoffs for their life, basically. With Matt Schwab as a quarterback, I think they can make a Super Bowl.
Oh. Okay. I was completely with you when you were talking about the Patriots and the Broncos. You were thinking exactly what I was thinking. And then you threw out the Texans' names. You said, they can't win in the playoffs. Look at what Houston's
yes, but, okay.
The only team that can beat the playoffs is Cincinnati.
And take out some of those friends and stuff and just look at the single team. With J.J. Watt sitting there, I look at this team, if they stay healthy, which is, that is a worry because if you lose Matt Schwab, I'm not sure how good they are behind that. And of course, you have to look at them with just, they have a lot of players who are on injury watch, but I like this team, oddly enough. It's a good team.
It's a good team, but so are the Patriots, and so are the Bengals, and so are the Broncos. Good's not good enough to get to
the... How do you assume the Bengals make it out, especially with their quarterback situation?
What?
I don't think the Bengals can make it.
You don't think the Bengals can make it? That's interesting, because the Bengals have A.J. Green, they have been Jarvis Greenhouse, and they get the prized Patriots effect this year. Three times they play teams that are coming off the Patriots, which means their defense is going to be exhausted. Same thing happened last year to the Niners. Let's look at what Houston's done. So 2 years ago at home, they defeated Cincinnati 31-10, and then went into Baltimore and lost 20-13. The next year, so they got one playoff win. Same thing happened the next year. Who they win against? Cincinnati. So unless they play Cincinnati in the playoffs, they're going to lose, it seems. They played against New England. They lost 41-28. This team has proved... I've lost faith in them in the playoffs. They struggled too much toward the end of the year. The Houston's good, they're not good enough.
Alright, so who is your Super Bowl pick? Who do you think is going to take out? Because there's just, the AFC is so up for grabs. There's a lot of teams who just kind of have hit. I mean, the Ravens look like they're probably too dismantled. You look at a lot of teams that just aren't going to be good enough to make the Super Bowl, and it looks like the NFC is definitely the better conference. But it's just who comes out of the AFC, that's my question.
I went with the Patriots by default. Listen, because I feel the exact way you do. I think the dynasty is over and that they are overranked. But you're also right about Peyton Manning not being good enough in the playoffs. And I think that there are a bunch of young teams that could potentially be better than them, but they don't have the experience. It's what we saw when the Thunder played the Heat in the finals 2 years ago. Many people thought the Thunder were the better team, they just weren't experienced enough. Next year, look out for Cincinnati. Look out for Kansas City. I have to go with New England this year, but I did take Seattle in the Super Bowl. So you.
Yeah, okay.
San Francisco or Houston? Who's going to win?
It's San Francisco over any... It's San Francisco or Seattle is going to win the Super Bowl. I see, unless of course, you know, calling these games, you try to pick the best team, but then, you know, who would have picked Baltimore last year? You know, especially going in the playoffs, I mean,
they were
so close to losing to Denver and stuff. It looked like they weren't going to beat the game of the year.
I thought they would lose that first game against Indianapolis.
Yeah, see, so, you know, you look at these teams and we make these picks, but of course, some team that could win out of the AFC, you're right, the Bengals could surprise a lot of people because they can win random games, especially Carson Palmer has a better career than people think. He's a good quarterback.
He is a good quarterback.
He just gets stuck in really bad situations.
And injuries. All right.
Yeah.
Houston, you were the first to say that today. Interestingly enough, everyone who came before you either said the Patriots or the Broncos. No one said Houston, an interesting pick and a risky one. We're almost at the two. Oh, yeah?
Yeah, it's maybe a risky pick, but you know, every team that you pick is a risky pick. You just gotta take where's the risk and where's the reward, and this team is up and coming while the other two teams that have been picked are kind of falling down.
I see where you're coming, and I appreciate you for going out on a limb like that. Now, we are near a two-hour mark. I can't believe I'm saying that. My question now, your last one. What playoff team from last year is most likely to disappoint this year?
You know, as much as I really, really hate to say this, the Vikings probably are going to end up, they won't get 10 wins. And the reason I say this is they're about as strong as last year, if not stronger. But two reasons. One, Adrian Peterson doesn't have the element of surprise that he is back. And two, their schedule is ridiculously tough. You look at them, and they also have teams like Baltimore and Cincinnati. They're playing Pittsburgh as a home game in London. I mean, it's not an easy schedule whatsoever. And you include that with the division they're in. The NFC North has three teams that are very strong with three very good quarterbacks. It's a really tough schedule, and that's why I think the Vikings could definitely disappoint this year.
I agree with you. The Vikings are not making the playoffs, but there's one thing that you said that caught my interest and makes me wonder about your Super Bowl pick with the San Francisco 49ers. You said that Adrian Peterson now lost his element of surprise. What makes him so different from San Francisco? What makes him so different from Colin Kaepernick?
Because the thing is, You're right on that. I mean, it makes it so... But the thing is, it really is that schedule. And also, as much as I would love Christian Ponder to become a lead quarterback with all these weapons, but he won't be. And there's just too much load on Adrian Peterson. Teams don't even have to cover passes really that much anymore. And they're just going to have to flounder, basically, especially with the schedule. It's like, they're playing tough defenses. They're not playing an easy schedule this year. Like last year they started out, their first game was in Jacksonville. That's not a difficult team, and we took overtime to beat them. Then we lost in Indianapolis, and that was one of our toughest games that year, and this year we have games that are just as tough, if not tougher.
and just too many of them. And plus, you're probably looking at splits with Chicago and then maybe sweep by Green Bay and us sweeping Detroit. That means there you go, 3-3 right there. I think they're going to be 7-9, 8-8.
All right, well, you know what? I appreciate you swallowing your pride, picking against the Purple Jesus, going out, picking the Houston Texans.
It's very hard for me to pick against my team, you know.
You,
I had to do a lot of good for this. And the second the Packers start sucking, I'm coming back on the show, just so you know that.
Okay. That's going to be a long time then.
All right.
Thanks for coming on. I know it's a late night. I appreciate it a lot. See you around.
All right, thanks for having me.
Talk to you later. Carl Moglein, and with that, at the 111-minute mark, we just have the awards left. MVP award, I was just getting started on this. The MVP award goes to a 64-year-old woman. She had tried this 4 times before, and on number 5, it worked. Her name's Diana Nyad. A 110-mile swim from Cuba to Florida without a shark tank. First woman ever to do that, 110 miles in the Atlantic Ocean, or maybe the Caribbean Sea, I'm not sure. She skipped Cuba, she got to Florida, good for her, so brave. So, she's the MVP of all the MVPs we've had in this show so far. An incredible feat from a 64-year-old woman who risked getting eaten alive by sharks. Swam 110 miles in the ocean / sea to get to Florida. Good for her. She's the MVP. Facepalm Award. Well, we've had a lot of facepalm moments lately. But how about we go with Ronnie Lott? I've mentioned that I was at the UCLA-Nevada game. Who knew that we'd be talking about UCLA and Nevada football more than once on this show? And it happens again. On the Pac-12 network set, following the UCLA-Nevada game, they were talking about it. Ronnie Lott is on that panel. Ronnie Lott got carried away doing late-night commentary. He fell off his chair, onto his back, and off the panel. Look up the GIF for that, or watch the video on Pac-12.com. It is absolutely hilarious. And our sympathy award. Last, but certainly not least, and again, a lot of people these days to feel sympathetic for. What should we go with? Hold on a second. It's almost there. Oh, I remember. I remember this one. Yep. Of course. Who can forget the t-shirt gun incident that happened in Arkansas? So, it turns out a person was shot. Normally you don't joke about people getting shot because it's wrong and people will frown upon you. And you are going to be hated by everybody. Unless it's a t-shirt gun. And you end up being okay. A t-shirt gun exploded during the season opener between the Arkansas Razorbacks and the UL Lafayette Ragin' Cajuns. Best name in college football. The Ragin' Cajuns. We just heard a loud explosion. It turned out it was a t-shirt gun. It injured an intern with the Arkansas's athletic department. Athletic marketing department. Luckily, he is okay. And now, you get to go around telling people that you were shot and you survived. So with that, our sympathy goes to the intern from Arkansas. That's it. 114 minutes of sports. Our longest episode ever on Rookies Roundup. I know it's Labor Day and you're not supposed to work, but no one told me it's not worth talking about sports. It's fun. It's great. Appreciate you guys listening. Especially if you found a way to listen to this entire thing. Oh my god. You are the real MVP. You are the true Purple Jesus. I can't get over that. Purple Jesus. You learn something every day. You'll learn something every day. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next week. I'm not going to tell you when I'm going to do it because I had to reschedule this episode. Not once, but twice. Enjoy the first week of the NFL season, MLB. We're coming down the stretch. Make your predictions in the comment section below. Check out all the shows on National Sports. Check out our Facebook page, National Sports, our Twitter, at all caps National Sports 1, and our Instagram page, National_sports. One last thing before I go. Last week I said I was hoping that Madden would be a success. It is. I love it. The owner mode is great. I finally got to relocate a team to Los Angeles, and it's not an Arena League football team called the Los Angeles Kiss. The Jacksonville Jaguars are now under my control, and I'm renaming them the Los Angeles Aftershocks. Does that matter in real life? No. But it's keeping me entertained. Great job from Madden this year for not disappointing. Alright. Again, huge thank you to you guys. Nearly 2 hours of Rookies Roundup. That's insane. We've come so far, and this is just our 6th episode yet. Enjoy football season beginning. Hope you enjoyed the show. Tell everyone you know about it. Listen to it. Just tell everyone you can. Bad press is better than no press. Someone clearly told Miley Cyrus that. Oh, yeah. We couldn't go throughout the night without making one zinger with Miley Cyrus. She's gone off the wall. Hopefully, we got other athletes who will get themselves back on track, like Johnny Manziel. Before I continue to ramble, I'm going to hit the stop button for the 5th time. Thank you for listening. Tell everyone. We will see you next week.